What's up, guys and gals? Welcome back to the Nerd Castle. Today in the world of indie games, we'll be taking a look at a title called Phantom Brigade. You guys will know that I am a big fan of anything having to do with mechs. Usually Western mecha, in all honesty. I'm a big fan of, like, Mech Warrior, big fan of Battletech, Steel Battalion, Chrome Hounds, all that stuff. But every now and again, I'll dabble in a little bit of Gundam here and there. Phantom Brigade, I think, is more on, like, the Gundam aspect of mechs. So this is a game about big, speedy mech boys running around, you know, drifting, doing all that kind of stuff while spraying machine guns at each other and trying not to knock down civilian buildings. It's got a campaign. Along the way, you're going to customize your mechs and add different guns and paint jobs and stuff like that to them. The game has itself billed as, like, a tactical RPG in its description. And we'll talk about, I guess I've played the game for about 2 hours so far, plus whatever we do in this video. I have not played this game since it came out on Epic in its original early access, and so last night I put some time into it. And I do have some thoughts about the game that I'll try to compile at the end of the video. Hopefully somebody will timestamp that for you, just in case you were trying to figure out whether or not Phantom Brigade is the proper game for you. I've got a link for you down below in the description if you wanted to get the game. This is a 1.0. This is one of those rare instances where the game is not in early access. I know that, like, almost never happens anymore in the realm of gaming. So this is actually a done, completed project. And then down there, you can also find a link to my Discord and my Twitch stream, just in case you wanted to hang out live. What I'm going to do is I'm just going to load up a save where I'm like a couple, like an hour or two into the game. I'm not super far into the game, but I'm like an hour or two in. And we're going to go ahead and just do some crisis management. Now, this is Headmark. We are inside, so this is kind of the world map of the game right here. In between missions, little crises are going to come up. The ultimate goal of the game, I think, is that we're, like, some kind of resistance fighter. I don't know, dude. Like, the storyline to this game is kind of, like, flowery, but also, like, not really super well explained. As far as I can tell, we are, like, remainders of a resistance faction that's fighting back against some kind of occupying force. There is also another resistance faction called the Army, or, like, the Home Guard, that will occasionally assist us with our tasks. But we're basically kind of like a Red Faction guerrilla group that's running around kind of like putting out fires in order to ease the burdens of the greater army or whatever, and fight on behalf of the civilians who I think are being oppressed. I don't know, they don't really give you a whole lot to go off of other than, like, the red guys are bad. I don't know if the red guys are actually bad. I don't want to get drawn into any conversations about the moral and the good. But anyways, for the purposes of this video, red guys bad, okay? They do all the bad things that they don't put their shopping cart away when they go back out to the parking lot after they buy their Wheaties. In general, they cut in line. The red guys are the enemy, and right now they are doing all of that debauchery over here on this right-hand side. And so we're going to have to take, we've got a little vehicle. As you can see right here, we've got a little APC that's got all of our mechs inside of it. So we need to go kind of respond to this crisis and or situation over here. In we go. Let's kind of see what they've got waiting for us for right now. Any closer and you'll lose the element of surprise, your scout reports as you approach the enemy commander's broken down convoy. Make sure you're ready to go, boss. Yeah, let's suit up. Let's suit up for the battle. I'm ready. Let's suit it on up. All right, so this is our battle map. It looks like we're going to be entering from this side. It's a bit topographic, so it looks like we're going to be moving through kind of like a central channel. I don't know exactly what that is right there, but it does give you kind of like hints as to what the mission may have for you when you look at it. So engage a group of hostiles with no support and eliminate them. Can be accomplished with 2 to 3 units. Okay. Do I have any extra units that have been assembled? It looks like we've only got the 2 mechs for right now. I thought I salvaged, like, last night, I thought I salvaged a 3rd mech, but it appears as though we're missing a left arm for it. So I don't think that's actually going to work out. We could take a look at our pilots. Thus far, the pilots don't seem to have, like, level ups, and they don't seem to have abilities, and they don't, like, they've got, like, their health, they've got, like, concussion resistance, and they've got, like, a 3rd stat, and that's pretty much, like, it from what I've seen so far. Yeah, so they've got their health, their concussion resistance, and their concussion point, I suppose. And so, like, they don't really seem to develop much more than that, and I think that's really kind of a missed opportunity with this game. And it really deprives the RPG aspect of the game that I think actually could use some filling out. So we've got two mechs here. We've got the longbow and we've got the protector. The longbow is basically just your basic rifleman unit. The protector is going to be a tall tower shield unit that can block shots and basically tank to its left arm however it sees fit. Let's go ahead and squad on up. There they are. My paint jobs are a little bit dubious right now because I haven't sat down and actually painted my mechs, unfortunately. So, like, they're the same color. As you can tell, I stole these arms right here from the red guys. And then I don't know where the orange stuff came from. Probably started out by default with it. Day one, 6:05 in the evening. All right, well, at least it looks like a reasonably open place. Like, it doesn't look like we're going to have to deal with, like, civilians or anything else going wild out here. Rebels are clinging to rumors about a Phantom Brigade, huh? Let's show them why only children believe in fairy tales. Whatever you say, sir, keep the comms on your unit intact. This VIP is piloting. Try to surround and concuss him. Yeah, so enemies can be defeated in any number of ways. They've got, like, different body part damage. Concussive damage basically means that the pilot has been knocked out because the cockpit is rattling too much, effectively. It looks like our concussion damage is doubled when we hit it from the back. So let's hit it from the back. Once the VIP is eliminated, prepare to retreat. To retreat, move your units over here and plan a retreat action. Gotcha. So this game, let's talk about this game because I think it's got some unique ideas here. I think some of them come from games kind of like Hybrid Heaven or games like Frozen Synapse or maybe like Door Kickers. It's a game where you plot on a timeline what you want to happen. And so it's kind of like a hybrid in between turn-based and real-time. The storyline reasoning for why you're able to do this is because your mechs come equipped with, like, this prototype device that allows you to see 5 seconds on into the future. And so this down here, this 5-second timeline, basically this entire battle is going to be broken up into 5-second chunks. We need to eliminate this pilot over here, so we're going to start with, I think, our rifleman. And our rifleman's going to need to do a move order. And really, we want to keep the enemy in between those two lines right there. You see how there's two circles around our character? The two circles that you're seeing, that's the optimal range. If they're inside of those two circles, you're not going to be able to hit them very well. If they're outside those two circles, you're not going to be able to hit them very well. But if they fall in between those two circles, you're good to go. And so we kind of want to maintain and keep this guy inside of our optimal range during this 5-second period. So we're going to schedule the mech to run, basically, and follow this guy. You can see that on the timeline right here. And then we're also going to schedule some attacks. So we need to attack while we're in optimal range. Honestly, we can start firing basically from the moment we hit the ground. So let's go ahead and fire into the back of him. We will follow. And the other thing that we need to be aware of is we need to be aware of our heat. You see that little thermometer right there on our timeline that's going up and down as our attack phase gets from, like, its beginning to its terminus? We need to watch our temperature, because if the temperature gets too high, our mech starts to melt down and it starts taking damage. So we don't want to fire too much in rapid succession if we can help it. Continue firing at him. Where's that going to put my heat? Okay, our heat looks good. I think we're going to want to continue following up with this guy. Actually, it looks like he stops right there. I don't think he goes any further. Like, he kind of just ends his turn right there. Yeah, so we may actually want to schedule, like, a third attack once the heat kind of gets down. There we go. And so their turn is basically done. There's not a whole lot. So I think this system is, like, really, really robust. Like, I think this is a really interesting combat system. But what I've run into thus far is that there's not, like, pilot abilities. And there's not, like, mech abilities. You're pretty much limited to, like, move, wait, or attack. Those are basically, like, your three options. And you kind of, like, layer those three things together. And from what I've seen in the opening bits of the game, I don't know if it opens up a little bit later on into the game. But from what I've seen so far, it doesn't feel like there's a huge number of tactical options. So if you've played something like BattleTech, we'll use that as kind of like the core idea here. Like in BattleTech, you have the ability to select and choose which of your fusillade fires, down to individual missile packs and weapon packs. You've got kind of like mods, and you've got things that add on to those weapons that make them perform in different ways. On top of that, you've got pilot abilities that can modify your aim chances or allow your pilots to do things that otherwise the AI itself cannot do in order to kind of like interject a little bit of chaos to the battlefield. This game seems very, very much by the numbers by comparison. There aren't a whole lot of abilities or things you can do to kind of like shake up the timeline or like change outcomes for the enemy or, you know, just kind of like peacock it up, I guess, and feel different from the AI. That was one of the things that I sort of noticed while I was playing around with it. So we've got our attack going off right there. They're going to move forward. I can get another batch of shots off right there. And then my suggestion would be, we're going to actually have to put a wait order right here. Yeah, we need a wait order. And then we actually don't have room on that bridge to close where I want to close to. I could get them like right to there though. It's not ideal, but it'll have to do for right now. Once you're done and you've set up what you want to do on your turns, you just execute. That's it. So if you look right there, all of the things that we planned on doing, they are going to unload on that mech. It looks like we destroyed his legs. In moving this guy over to cover, it looks like we avoided any problems with that secondary mech. Command, we just lost the VIP, requesting permission to fall back. Over. So now we have the ability to extract. We can retreat from combat. This entire fight was basically just showing us that, like, hey, sometimes there's going to be fights where you just need to knock out one guy and bail. So what we need to do for right now is we need to start planning to get the hell on out of here. And you can actually plan as many 5-second gaps into the future as you want to. It doesn't really matter. Let's go ahead and execute that right there. Pretty solid chance we're going to take a little bit of damage because, yeah, he's going to get... Well, actually, he sprayed that first batch of gunfire straight into the mountainside, so it didn't really matter. I think we're okay. You guys continue running. It doesn't look like he's closing off with us very rapidly. The camera is customizable. You can rotate it around. The game does give you really solid camera control. Another thing that the game seems to be missing, which is kind of like an odd omission. I was sort of expecting that the game would have a unified battle camera. And what I mean by that is when you get to the end of a fight, it would have been really, really nice. Because the entire game is about replaying and watching your turn over and over and over again until you find that perfect sequence of events that brings you out on top. What I would have liked to have seen is a finalized camera. Like when you get to the end of the battle, there should be like a replay all. And it's got like a cinematic kind of drone camera that's flying over the battlefield and picking angles based on where you're firing from and where the enemy's firing from. It kind of converts it almost into like its own little, I don't know, animation or whatever. We need you to extract. There you go. Retreat right at the beginning of your turn. Doesn't really matter. And then you get on into there. And then you are going to retreat, like, right when you get into that zone. There you go. Everybody get out of here. Easy peasy mission. At the end of every battle, it's going to allow you to do salvage rights. This is very similar to MechWarrior or BattleTech if you've ever played those before. You basically get to pick what you want from the enemy's cache. There can be things like other body parts that will drop. There will be things like machine guns. These come in different ranks. This little number that's listed on the left-hand side, that's basically how strong the weapon is. So you will find many, many MG3 Hurricanes. Some of them will be green quality, some of them will be blue quality. The game's got like a little bit of a Diablo feel to it, where the quality of the weapon can be different. Like this SR1 Midway up here is green, which means that it's going to be like slightly better than a normal option. And so, I don't really know what I want. They've got like a whole bunch of arms and stuff over here. So you have multiple things you can do here at the end of combat. You can choose to salvage these pieces from the enemy, and you've got a salvage budget up here. You can dismantle it. What that will do is it'll just convert it into supplies, and supplies are just sort of like this conceptualization currency you use to do various things. I'll probably take... So we've already got the midway up here. I'll probably take the machine gun. I'll probably take the torso. And that looks like about the best I can do right there. I'm okay with it. Begin the salvage run. So we basically picked up everything except the legs, and then we converted the legs into Coke cans. After a victory like that, you're no doubt on the invading army's radar. Good. Hopefully eliminating a key target in the province will wither their resolve. These invaders should know that the Phantom Brigade is here and here to stay. Your crew, expectant, gathers around you. In triage terms, you don't want somebody to be expectant. You look each of them in the eye and take a breath, encouragement ready on your tongue. That's not encouragement. That's called Mountain Dew, brother. Jacked up on Mountain Dew. On the other side of the province, things aren't good. The home guards' comms are harried. Ambush, heavy losses, surrounded. They need your help, and they need it right now. So I have 30 hours to go and rescue the home guard. Battles will break out in contested provinces. Aid the home guard. Turn the tide. Don't take too long. You'll lose the province. I don't know if there's like a fail state to the game so far. I've never actually just like sat here until a mission expired to see what happens. It's one of those things that probably somebody that's better at their job would have done. But alas, I am not better at my job. So with some of the things that we picked up, I think we may be able to like add different parts here and make ourselves a little bit stronger. It looks like we can put a level 2 Elbrus on this, or we could go for the Nox chassis right there, which will give us quite a bit more HP. I don't know what the downside to that is. Standard mass performance, useful for versatility. Yeah, throw the Nox on there, I guess. There we go. The Nox has been added on in there. We'll throw the level 2 Elbrus legs on there. We'll throw the arms on there. And we will throw the arms on there. And as you can see, all of your mechs, they have kind of like a gear score. It's listed up here at the top. And it's going to compare that gear score to the mission that you're undertaking to let you know exactly like how prepared you might be. I don't really want a shield. A machine gun is like an interesting idea. I'm not a big fan of sniper rifles, so I don't know if I would actually run a sniper rifle. It does have a precision perk on it, though. You know, I'm kind of tempted to play around with the machine gun. I haven't played with a machine gun yet. I want to see. I like how they put like a Weaver rail or something on top of that giant ridiculous robot gun. That's actually kind of hilarious. The protector. Is there anything I can do for the protector to kind of like bring them up? Yeah, I've got like a Elbrus torso right there. I've got like some Nox arms that I can throw on there just for like the extra HP. Oh, looks like I got a new shield too. All right, well, I'll throw a new shield on this guy. That sounds pretty good. And I've got a level 2 assault rifle as well. So we actually had a whole bunch of upgrades that could go onto the protector. You can repaint your mechs. You can rename your mechs. You can customize them to your heart's content. I haven't, like, paint-jobbed mine yet because, in my mind, they haven't quite earned it. I haven't figured out exactly just yet how you build another mech from scratch, even when you have all the parts. Like, I should have enough parts here, right? So I've got a torso, I've got two arms, and I have some leggies. So I think I can build another mech, but I'm wondering if it's like storyline locked, and I'm not allowed to do that yet. I don't know. After looking at it, I'm pretty sure this machine gun is going to overheat this mech in one shot. Like its alpha appears to be too high. But I don't care, I live my life on the edge. I'm going to do it anyways because I love machine guns. Alright, let's get on the road. We got a job to take care of here. Let's see if we can wipe out some of these nerds. Into the fray we go. Suit up! Apparently we're just in time right now. Looks like the enemy is threat level, like, 2. They're already here. The enemies are ready to engage immediately, so keep your wits about you. A mix of reserve troops led by oddball elite specialists, what they lack in skill and experience, they will make up for with sheer numbers. Okay. Let's go ahead and put somebody in. Apparently, Devin Tay, Mr. Tango, is taking part in this fight. Squad up. Let's roll. Interesting battlefield. I like that battle map layout. Wasn't quite what I was expecting. It sort of reminds me like of when you were playing like Death Stranding and you like walk into that initial area where there's like all the buildings like at the start of the game. When you first start out, you know what I'm talking about? Like, it's got like kind of the archways. I don't know. That's what it reminded me of. All right, people, let's help the home guard and get out of here. Brigade's here, folks. Look sharp and aim true. We're going to make it out of this. No promises. All right. We're going to want to deny line of sight as much as possible. Home guard units are cut off. You will either have to regroup or flank the enemy. We've got a heavy armored unit, but they are capable of dashing with thrusters. Okay, that'll be useful to have. This enemy has a beam weapon. The longer it stays on the target, the higher damage it inflicts. Okay, so we're probably going to have to dash that guy. It looks like he's going to have line of fire from like right there until he comes into that little corridor. So we're going to need to deny lines of fire pretty aggressively. So he's still going to have that line of fire right there. If I can stay behind a building, I think we're good. I don't really have any indirect fire weapons, though. The other option is that we make it over to here. But yeah, we're going to get lasered on that side. Okay, so you're going to come over to here. Actually, you may not even need to go that far. They can go to, like, right here. Unless the building folds. And then we kind of give, like, a wait command. Because he's going to go back around that way. Yeah, maybe set up right there. And that machine gun's gonna overheat us, right? Yeah, she has like no chance to hit that. We gotta get closer. Okay. Machine gun's got a little bit shorter of a range. We can set up right there, though. I think that's alright. Yeah, we can maybe pop off an attack right there, but we're optimal range blocked on that side. So that heavy beam weapon, I don't think we're gonna be able to do too much on this turn. You basically just run over here and flank. I don't know how long that's going to take you. Just do it. Oh, yeah. I forgot. The home guard guys are under my command over here. We are going to need to get to them. So those tanks are going to cruise on up, and they're basically going to fill this gap. Okay, you, sir. I need you to dash over to there. And then you're going to move over to there. What kind of gun do you have? You've got a assault rifle. Good. Okay. So let's take a look at what we got here. You can pop an assault rifle shot. Actually, we may want to get rid of this run. Let me see if I can dash a little bit better here. So let's say I dash behind cover right there. Yeah, and then I pretty much just need you right there. That's an optimal range. So we'll bust a couple shots into the back of him while he's shooting at the homies. That should still protect him from the tank, and then we can dash out of it on the next turn. This guy right here, we're going to need him to get into cover. No way around it. I mean, it's either that or we outflank him over here and we get around behind him. Some interesting observations I think we can take, but let's go with my initial gut plan. So they're both shooting. Okay. You move back to there. Now that I've got that set up, basically start busting shots as early as you possibly can on that front tank. And I think that's everybody pretty much resolved. Execute the turn. Okay, nice shots right there. Oh, big missile out to our mech right there. Didn't know this guy had a missile launcher. Oh, it has beam plus MLS. Yeah, okay, so he's got a missile launcher secondary. That kind of sucks. We're going to have shots coming from over here. Does this guy also have a missile launcher? He's a sniper. Okay, that's fine. I just need to deprive him of line of sight then, if I want this to work. And that should be easy. I just got to march forward a little bit. This mech did take a pretty good scuffing to its right arm from that missile salvo, which I think is a bit of a bummer. You get over to here. He's shooting right there. Okay, never mind then. What I just need from you then is to move over to there. Don't get too crazy. And in the meantime, where are you at? Are you going to be able to get here in time? Not really. I was hoping this mech would get here in time to put some suppressive scow on this dude, but I don't think it's going to happen. He's got to be pretty beat up. Yeah, he's got 55% of his health missing. So we don't need a lot to knock this guy over. Upsetting. That shot is going to go off. Potentially, I can just have this guy wait behind this building right here. Because if this dude advances, I don't think he's going to be able to advance fast enough. So if I dash you to there, that kind of closes the gap. That is optimal range right there. Okay, pump some shots into his back then. Hopefully those two overlapping fires right there will get rid of this guy. Like, I love the tremendous... So, like, this is one of those games that, like, as I was saying, there's not a whole lot of activities you can do with your mechs that are outside of, like, attack, move, dash, defend. But there is something compelling going on here. Like, this is addictive setting up your turns. Like, I think some people will find this a little bit tedious, and they'll just want to, like, get to it, and they'll prefer, like, a more AP-based combat system. But there is a sort of fastidious nature to this game in, like, forcing setups and making things look the way you want them to. And having, like, because the game gives you really all the information you need to be aware of in order to do what it is that you want to do. Dash back over to there, which should block that shot right there with line of sight, hopefully. This guy's taking his shot over here. I think that's gonna break my line of sight right there, but I'm gonna try to get a second shot off. I don't think the gun's cooled enough anyways. Yeah, our heat's kind of high. It's tough to say. I think we're just going to have to kind of go for it, man. So with him over there... Does he have a beam on him? What does he have? An auto cannon. So he's machine gunning his way up here. Gotcha. So he's returning fire, dashing away. He should catch a couple bullets right there, but not all of them. And then after he comes back over here, I feel like he kind of like repositions over to this side. And just to finish off that tank right there, we give it another attack. Like, the game is really easy to figure out. Like, it's not a super difficult tactical strategy game because all the information is presented right in front of you. Like, if you choose to ignore it, you know exactly where all the enemies are going to attack. You know exactly where all your stuff is going to happen. And then at that point, it's just you arranging your flowchart to effectively counter what the enemy is going to do. All right, what's going on? Oh, you got him! Nice, dude. Okay, so these guys rush to the aid. Okay, so what happened here? I need a replay. So he fired over there. That fired over there. He missed all of his shots. We machine gunned him down, so he's dead. Sometimes I gotta watch my replay 2 and 3 times because the battlefields are kind of large. And my ADD forces me, like, I need to know what happened in every single area so that I can parse it all. He just fired out a bullet, but is that gonna hit? I don't know if that's gonna hit. Technically, I can get in behind that building right there, or we can walk this corridor. I kind of feel like I have a lot of people that are out of position right now. I think that's perfectly acceptable. You can do that. Unfortunately, I think I gotta plan this guy's move first, because when they overlap like that, it's not letting me select this unit. So I think I've gotta plan what he's gonna do first. You're going to come down this way, I guess. And if you can knock shots at this dude, like, knock shots at him, I guess. I'm in optimal range, but that's a 23% chance to hit. What if I put it a little... Ah, you've got to not be in motion. Okay. So you have to be at a full stop for that gun to really get its mileage. You... go ahead and do me a favor and set up right there. You've got dashies, and dashies are fun. Dashers, dashers. So if I dash you over to there, he's in optimal range right there. He is no longer in optimal range, so we're going to have to do a wait action till the end of that attack. I think I messed up that wait, though. Yeah, you're picking what direction he faces with the wait as well. Because you're trying to optimize... Some people have questioned what the wait does in this game, like what the point of it is. Like, why do you choose your facing when you wait? Because you're trying to isolate the damage going to different body parts, basically. So, like, if you have to wait in a spot, they're letting you have your choice. Do you want to get shot in the left arm, the right arm? Like, what is your facing here? Basically, it's you taking agency on getting filled full of lead. And then what I need to do is he needs to fall back to maintain optimal range right there. And he can probably bust another shot from there, too. That leaves me with this guy. This guy is way outside the normal engagement, so we're just going to have him go over to there. And that's pretty much it. Oh, he did eat that sniper shot. That did 150 damage. No good. Oh, wow, we're kind of getting, like, toasted. This guy's actually got, like, mad buck-buck. Oh, this guy's tougher than I thought. That's unfortunate. Okay. Well, confirm that removal. You get on top of the building. Why are you going around? No, don't go around. Yeah, I guess go up to there. That's fine. Once you've got the high ground, go ahead and... Oh, he moved. I was looking at his initial position. Okay. Well, then actually what I need from you is to move down to here. And you will bust a gunshot into the side of his head. And if your heat gets low enough, you will bust yet another gunshot into the side of his head. You are going to be falling back and displacing this entire time, while facing off against this dude. Once your heat's low enough, hit him with another shot. You are about to get totaled. You're about to have a bad day, unfortunately. And I don't really know... I mean, just keep shooting, I guess. Man, that guy is taking a pounding. Did we get him? I think we got him. I was gonna say, man, that guy took a lot of bullets. My man did not want to die. I had like focused fire from three mechs on that dude, just like go, just mag dumping him for like three turns straight, and the man did not want to let go. He was a clinger, man. He was a clinger. Alright, so we've got a number of mechs here that have been destroyed. We've got to decide what we want to take. Our default, it looks like we got a magical Elbrus, which has the plated perk. We've also got a Nox Heavy Torso with improved cooling. We more than likely want to put that on our machine gun mech, since our machine gun mech is basically overheating by default the second it discharges its weapon. We got a level 3 shield right there. We got a couple of thrusters, so that's really, really good. That'll give the dash ability to some of our mechs, and so that'll be nice to have. So I think it's probably time to do my observations. Actually, I think time got away from me on this one. I didn't realize how far we were out on the actual timeline here, and I'm not being word punny about that. I've got a little timeline running on the side of the screen so I can keep track of how long the video is and like edited portions taken out and all that kind of stuff. So after 2 hours of playing Phantom Brigade, this is by no means a hugely conclusive review. Keep in mind that this is my first impressions of the game. I think there's a couple things I want to hit. So the things that I do like actually largely outnumber the things that I don't like. I think the game looks fantastic. Missiles explode, bullets fly all over the place, they ping off of stuff, environmental destruction looks cool. And while doing that, I personally have not had any performance issues. The game seems to run fine. The UI is ultra modern and mostly readable. Sometimes you lose little details in the sprawl of information, but actually I kind of like the UI in this game, and UIs aren't generally a thing that I take notice of. But this is a very, very slick game when it comes to UI design of the game. It has a very, very interesting combat system that draws from things like Frozen Synapse, and I think it mostly works intuitively and isn't going to require a huge amount of time and investment from the player to learn. Like, I felt like the combat was very, very intuitive. Once you play around with it for a little bit, it will come to you, and then pretty soon you'll be planning turns very, very rapidly. It seems to have a large chunk of gear. There seem to be a lot of items, there seems to be a lot of equipment, there seems to be a lot of armor, there seem to be mods on a lot of that equipment as they get more magical or like higher rarity. They've got little slots on them that you can mod out to increase your cooling or to lower your weight or to increase your armor, like little tweaks like that that you can put on the mechs that seem customizable and interesting. And every single battle that I've won so far positively just vomits new items at you. And so it doesn't seem like itemization is going to be a big problem. That's good, because I personally kind of feel like itemization is job number two after making sure the combat works in any mech game. Like, combat number one, customization number two. And so those things seem to be covered. The battles can be really, really spectacular. They give you a lot of eye candy, which I think is actually really, really important to this game working, because you spend like 10 minutes fastidiously planning your turns all the time, and it can get a little bit tedious. Like, I noticed, like, when I was halfway through planning a turn sometimes, I was like a little bit bored, but the one thing that kept me from being bored was the payoff of hitting the execute button and then watching kind of 5 seconds of battle play out. That made it all worth it. So those little moments where I started to be like yawn a little bit in the middle of planning a turn, it was mostly dispelled by the eye candy and the explosions and the gunfire that come for the 5 seconds after planning. And so I think the payoff was there and it worked. Otherwise, I probably would have bounced off of it. The things that worry me about this game, and honestly, there's only really one thing that I think kind of bothered me about the game, and that's the fact that, like, your pilots don't really seem to, like, have much customization to them. Like, if you take a look at, like, Battletech or XCOM, a big portion of, I think, what introduces asymmetry to fights and grants the player sort of these conflict-defining sense of agency are the extra abilities that your teams or your operators or your pilots, they bring to the battlefield as individuals. So independent of like their mech or independent of their loadout, in XCOM or in, you know, Battletech, your characters have abilities they can use no matter what mech you put them in or no matter what situation you put them in. In those previously mentioned games, you kind of learn and you grow and you make mistakes and you lose guys, and alongside the operators and pilots that survive, I find that you develop sort of like a sentimentality towards those characters over a 40-hour run. And that sentimentality, combined with their abilities and what makes them useful, it adds a sense of like emotional urgency to the game when that operator or that pilot is under threat and they might die. Or it makes you feel exhilarated when they pull off against all odds victories. I don't see really getting that out of Phantom Brigade because, like, from what I've seen so far, the pilots are kind of just like personality-deprived paper dolls. They don't really seem to have shout-outs or call-outs in combat that match up with the personality profiles that the game gives you, or anything else like that to kind of create that bit of immersion and attachment to them. The other thing is that the storyline doesn't seem to be anything too spectacular. It doesn't really need to be. I think most mech games boil down to, like, those guys over there, we need revenge against them. There are some really nice opening cinematics that look really, really cool with some cool cinematography and some cool soundtracking. But for the most part, the idea of the game I got from the storyline is like, red guys bad, go shoot red guys. Here's a picture to justify it of the red guys marching into a town. Look, there are civilians screaming and running in this still frame. Did you forget the red guys are bad? Go shoot them. And like, that's fine. I don't think a game like this really needs a super epic storyline. But I don't think it would have been hurt by a super epic storyline either. Eh. My name is Splattercat. I sift through the pile to find what's worthwhile in the world of indie games every single day so you don't have to. Today up on the chopping block, we were checking out the 1.0 of Phantom Brigade and doing our first impressions thereof. I will catch you all tomorrow with something hot and fresh off the indie skillet, but up until then, it's time for me to go. Bye, folks.